Assalamu alaikum students, I'm Dr. Haseeb. Hope you are fine. And today we are going to discuss a very important topic, not only for examination point of view, but also for your house job and clinical rotation. So today we are going to discuss diuretic agents. What are diuretics? How do they act on renal tubules? What is the clinical significance of these agents? And what is the mechanism of action behind each type of diuretic? So we will learn different types of diuretics. We'll learn how can we classify these agents. So these are the learning outcomes for today. And if time permits, we will discuss a little about acute kidney injury, AKI. So let's start. So diuretics are also known as water pills. So the simplest definition of diuretic agent or diuretic is any agent that increases urinary output. So this is the simplest and easiest definition of all. So any agent that increases urinary output will be labeled as diuretic. So most of the diuretics, they not only increase urinary output by increasing the output of water, but most of the diuretics, they also increase the excretion of other solutes as well. By other solutes, we are referring to the common sodium ions and chloride ions. So most of the diuretics, they not only increase the output of water through the urinary tract, but also excretion of sodium, chloride, and other ions as well. And remember, this increased output of water is secondary to inhibition of sodium reabsorption. By that we mean almost all the types of diuretics, they cause increased output of water by inhibiting sodium reabsorption. So when sodium reabsorption is inhibited, so this will cause more excretion of sodium through the urinary passages, and we will label this increased sodium excretion as natriuresis. So natriuresis in simple words means increased excretion of sodium ions through the urinary tract. So as we all know that water molecules, they have a tendency to follow the sodium ions. So whenever there is natriuresis or increased excretion of sodium ions, the water molecules, they tend to follow the sodium ions, and hence water molecules will also be excreted. So diuresis in most of the cases is secondary to natriuresis. Hence, we can say increased excretion of water is secondary to sodium reabsorption inhibition. And this is due to the phenomenon of osmosis of water. As we have discussed, the water molecules, they have a strong tendency to follow the sodium ions. So whenever there is natriuresis, this will be followed by diuresis as well. So diuresis is secondary to the phenomenon of natriuresis. So not only sodium and chloride, but there are other cations and anions that are secondarily involved. For example, potassium ions, chloride ions, these are the important ions besides calcium, magnesium. So reabsorption of these cations and anions are also influenced secondarily by sodium reabsorption. So not only excretion of sodium chloride, but also excretion of potassium, magnesium, calcium, all these solutes are secondarily influenced. And why do we use diuretic agents? The clinical significance, the idea behind using any type of diuretic agent is to reduce the extracellular fluid volume. And clinically speaking, we tend to use these agents in cardiology wards, patients with heart diseases, especially patients having edema and hypertension. So diuretics are used to reduce the ECF volume, whether there is edema, whether there is hypertension or other cardiovascular abnormality. So before moving on to the classification of diuretics, there are very important points that we should not miss. So one thing is for sure that diuretics, they increase the volume of urine or the urinary output. But these diuretics and the diuresis produced by these agents, this is different from that which occurs after ingestion of large volumes of water. So diuretic agents, they increase excretion of both solute and water. By solute, we are referring mainly the sodium ions. However, diuresis in response to ingestion of large volumes of water, this causes only excretion of water molecules. So there is diuresis but not natriuresis. So you have to distinguish the diuretic effect produced by the diuretic agent and the diuretic effect produced by ingestion of water. So almost all the diuretics, they inhibit sodium reabsorption. Whenever there is inhibition of sodium reabsorption, this will cause excretion of sodium ions through the urinary tract, and we will label it as natriuresis. So we have discussed that almost all the diuretics, except aquaretics. Now this is a new terminology, aquaretics. Aquaretics are strictly speaking not diuretics, but they are agents very similar to diuretics. So aquaretics, they cause water diuresis only. So any aquaretic agent will not cause excretion of sodium. So this is the difference between an aquaretic agent and a diuretic agent. Diuresis and natriuresis both occur in response to diuretic agent. However, aquaretics, they only cause water diuresis. They do not affect the sodium reabsorption. So we will discuss what are aquaretics. Strictly speaking, they are not classified under the heading of diuretics, but according to some, we can classify them as a subtype of diuretic, and these are mainly vasopressin antagonists. So vasopressin, as we all know, the other name for vasopressin is antidiuretic hormone. And if you remember, there are two types of receptors for vasopressin: V1 receptor and V2 receptor. V1 receptors are present in the smooth muscles of the blood vessel wall, whereas V2 receptors are present in the late distal tubule and the collecting duct of the renal tubules. And these aquaretics, they tend to act on the V2 receptors and block these receptors. And they are very helpful in treatment of SIADH. And I hope you all know what is meant by SIADH. SIADH stands for the syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, where inappropriate refers to hypersecretion of ADH. So aquaretic agents are to some degree helpful in treatment of SIADH. So to summarize, diuretics are agents that cause increased excretion of water secondary to increased excretion of sodium. That is, diuresis occurs secondarily to natriuresis. Another term is aquaretic or aquaretic agent. So aquaretics, they cause only water diuresis. They do not act on the sodium reabsorption. Now we will learn different types of diuretic agents. So there are different types. We will discuss the important ones only. The first type is the osmotic diuretics. As the name indicates, the osmotic diuretics, they are related to the osmosis. And whenever we use the term osmosis, we are referring to movement of water molecules. So the other type is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Very important enzyme, carbonic anhydrase. So the type of diuretic which inhibit this enzyme will be labeled as carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. The other type is loop diuretic. Here we are referring to the loop of Henle of the renal tubule. So the diuretics that specifically act on the Henle's loop are known as loop diuretics. Then we have thiazide diuretics, thiazide-like diuretics, and potassium retaining diuretics or potassium sparing diuretics. So those diuretic agents which tend to spare the potassium ions, also known as potassium retaining diuretics. And there are two subtypes of potassium sparing diuretics. One of them is the sodium channel blocker, and the other one is aldosterone blocker or the aldosterone antagonist. So both sodium channel blockers and aldosterone antagonists, both are collectively known as potassium sparing diuretics. Now one thing to note is that water itself can act as a diuretic agent. So besides water, ingestion of alcohol, that is ethanol, may give you a diuretic response as well. So we can add water, ethanol, and xanthines like caffeine to that list as well. Moreover, we have different acidifying salts, for example, ammonium chloride, calcium chloride. We can add these salts, acidifying salts, to this list as well. And the last is the vasopressin V2 antagonist or the aquaretics. So this is the list of different types of diuretics. We will discuss the important ones, especially the first six are very important for examination point of view. So you are supposed to know the types of diuretics and the examples of the important types. For example, osmotic diuretics include mannitol, glucose, sorbitol, urea, sucrose. All these are classical examples of osmotic diuretics. Mannitol is very important. We will learn how mannitol acts as a diuretic agent. Then acetazolamide is the classical example of carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So acetazolamide is a prototype drug. This is the classical example of CA inhibitor. Then there are other agents like furosemide, bupropionate, ethacrynic acid. All these agents, they act on the Henle's loop. All these are examples of loop diuretics. Then we have chlorothiazide and hydrochlorothiazide. The thiazide diuretics and the thiazide-like diuretics, both are very similar. The mechanism of action of thiazide and thiazide-like diuretics is the same. Now, another important type of diuretic is the potassium-sparing diuretic. And you are supposed to know the at least two examples of each type, triamterene and amiloride. These are the examples of sodium channel blockers. Spironolactone and eplerenone, these are the examples of aldosterone receptor blockers. So all these are potassium retaining diuretics. Caffeine can act as a diuretic agent as well. Similarly, acidifying salts like ammonium chloride, calcium chloride, all these can act as diuretics. So we will focus on the first six types. These are the diuretics which are examined which are important for examination point of view for you people as well. So this is the summary, this is the list. You can refer to Ganong's physiology. You can see vasopressin V2 receptor antagonist. These are the aquaretics, tolvaptan or lixivaptan. These are the aquaretic agents. So you can see they inhibit the actions of antidiuretic hormone, also known as vasopressin. So water, ethanol, aquaretics, mannitol is osmotic diuretic. Then we have caffeine and theophylline. These are xanthines, acidifying salts like calcium chloride, ammonium chloride, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like acetazolamide, thiazide diuretics, loop diuretics, and potassium sparing diuretics. Now you are supposed to know the site of action and the mechanism of action of the important types of diuretics. For example, you can see in this table on your right hand side, this is the site of action of each type of diuretic agent. So as you can see, mannitol, which is an osmotic diuretic, the site of action is the proximal tubule, right? Similarly, loop diuretics, as the name indicates, loop diuretics, they act on the thick ascending Henle's loop. Thiazide diuretics, they act on the distal tubule. Hydrase inhibitors, they act on the proximal tubule, whereas the potassium sparing diuretics, aldosterone antagonists, and the sodium channel blockers, remember, aldosterone antagonists and sodium channel blockers, collectively they are known as potassium sparing diuretics. And all these diuretics, they act on the late distal tubule and the collecting duct. So you have to remember the site of action of each type of diuretic. Now we will learn, we will discuss the mechanism of action of these diuretic agents. We will start with the CA inhibitor or the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Remember, the prototype drug, the prototype diuretic agent for carbonic anhydrase inhibitor is acetazolamide. And this drug acts on the proximal tubule. And as the name indicates, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they block the action of carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So whenever the enzyme action is inhibited, this will cause inhibition of the bicarbonate reabsorption. So whenever there is inhibition of bicarbonate reabsorption, most of this bicarbonate will be excreted through the urinary tract. Hence, excretion of bicarbonate ions will increase. Then we have loop diuretics, furosemide, bumetanide, ethacrynic acid. All these are classical loop diuretics. These loop diuretics, as we have discussed, they act on the thick ascending segment of the Henle's loop. And remember the name of transporter which is inhibited. Sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter. One sodium, one potassium, 2 chloride co-transporter. This is an example of secondary active co-transporter. And this transporter is located in the thick ascending limb of Henle's loop. So all the ions are, reabsorption of all these ions are affected. So reabsorption of sodium is inhibited, reabsorption of potassium is inhibited, reabsorption of chloride is inhibited. Hence, all these ions will be excreted through the urinary tract. So not only sodium, but chloride and potassium, all these ions will be excreted through the renal tract. Another thing to remember about loop diuretics is that these loop diuretics, they tend to increase the excretion of calcium ions as well. So that is why we can use this loop diuretic in treatment of hypercalcemia as well, right? So the next type of diuretic is the thiazide diuretic, and the prototype drugs include chlorothiazide and hydrochlorothiazide, and these agents, they act on the distal tubule, the proximal portion or the early part of the distal tubule, also known as the cortical diluting segment. And the type of transporter which is inhibited is the sodium chloride cotransporter, just like the sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter located in the thick ascending limb. Another second reactive cotransporter is located in the distal tubule, and this is the sodium chloride cotransporter. So inhibition of this cotransporter will inhibit the reabsorption of both the sodium ions and the chloride ions. Hence, both the sodium and chloride ions will be excreted. A distinguishing feature between loop diuretic and thiazide diuretic is its effect on the calcium reabsorption. As we have discussed, that loop diuretics, they inhibit calcium reabsorption and promote calcium excretion. Thiazide diuretics, on the other hand, they inhibit the excretion of calcium ions. So opposite effect on calcium excretion. So loop diuretics are used in the treatment of hypercalcemia, whereas thiazide diuretics are used in treatment of hypercalciuria. Hypercalcemia is increased calcium ions in the ECF of blood. Hypercalciuria is increased amount of calcium in the urine. So one is promoting calcium excretion, the other one is inhibiting. So one type of diuretic is used in treatment of hypercalcemia. The other, due to its opposite effect, is used in treatment of hypercalciuria. So this is a distinguishing feature between loop diuretic and thiazide diuretic. And then we have potassium sparing or potassium retaining diuretics. And when we use the term potassium sparing diuretics, we are referring to not only the aldosterone antagonists but also the sodium channel blockers. Both aldosterone antagonists and sodium channel blockers are collectively called as potassium retaining diuretics. And the prototype of aldosterone blocker is spironolactone. Spironolactone is an aldosterone antagonist, whereas triamterene and amiloride, these are the examples of sodium channel blockers. So whether sodium channel blockers or aldosterone antagonists, all these diuretics, they act on the distal tubule and the late collecting duct. So spironolactone will inhibit all the actions of aldosterone. If you remember the aldosterone on sodium, potassium and hydrogen ions, all the actions of aldosterone will be reversed or inhibited. So inhibition of sodium reabsorption will take place, inhibition of potassium secretion and hydrogen secretion will take place because the aldosterone is inhibited. So this will promote the excretion of sodium and inhibit the excretion of potassium and hydrogen ions. So these are the most important types of diuretic agents: carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, loop diuretics, thiazide diuretics, and potassium sparing diuretics. Potassium sparing diuretics include both aldosterone antagonists, that is pyranolactone, and sodium channel blockers, that is triamcinolone and amiloride. So you must not forget the site of action and the type of transporter or enzyme which is inhibited. Now in this figure you can see the classical structure of a nephron. This is the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus. This is the early proximal tubule and the late proximal tubule. This is the descending limb, the hairpin band, and the ascending limb, the thin ascending limb, followed by the thick ascending limb of Henle's loop. And as we move on, we have distal tubule, early distal tubule, and late distal tubule, followed by the collecting duct. So this is the classical structure of a nephron. You can see the line of demarcation between the cortical part and the medullary part. So now we will locate the type of diuretic. Mannitol is the prototype drug for osmotic diuretic. And this osmotic diuretic, they act on which segment of nephron? Here, the proximal convoluted tubule. So this will cause osmosis. Then we have acetazolamide. Acetazolamide is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Just like osmotic diuretic, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they also act on the same segment of the nephron, that is the proximal tubule. So in the proximal tubule, we have actions of osmotic diuretic and carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. As we move on towards the Henle's loop, you can see the role of loop diuretics here at number 3. And these loop diuretics, they act on specifically the thick ascending limb of Henle's loop. And if you remember, the transporter which is inhibited is 1 sodium, 1 potassium, 2 chloride secondary active co-transporter. So loop diuretics will inhibit this sodium, potassium, 2 chloride secondary active co-transporter here on the thick ascending limb. Distal to it is the role of thiazide and thiazide-like diuretics here at number 4. And the type of transporter which is inhibited is sodium chloride secondary active co-transporter. And this co-transporter is located in the distal tubule. So all the thiazide diuretics, the thiazide-like diuretics, they tend to inhibit this sodium chloride co-transporter located in the distal tubule. And at the end, we have potassium-sparing diuretics at number 5. Here you can see in the late distal tubule and the collecting duct. This is the site of action for potassium-sparing diuretic, late distal tubule and the collecting duct. So all the aldosterone antagonists, all the sodium channel blockers, they will act on the distal tubule and collecting duct. Now this figure depicts the same thing. This is a little bit descriptive than the previous slide. You can see the classical nephron, the proximal tubule, the thin descending limb, the hairpin band, the thin ascending limb, followed by the thick ascending limb, the distal tubule, early and late, and the collecting duct. So this is the classical nephron structure. So at the proximal tubule, the agents that act is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Remember, acetazolamide is the prototype. This will act at the proximal tubule. Then at thick ascending limb, we have loop diuretics. All the loop diuretics, especially furosemide, bumetanide, ethacrynic acid, they will block the sodium potassium 2 chloride second reactive co-transporter here. And thiazide diuretics, they act on the distal tubule. They will block the sodium chloride second reactive co-transporter here. And this is the site of action for potassium sparing drugs. Remember, both aldosterone antagonists and sodium channel blockers both act here at the distal tubule. The prototype for aldosterone antagonist is spironolactone, and the classical examples for sodium channel blockers include amiloride and triamterene. So this is a descriptive diagram. So mannitol, very important osmotic diuretic agent, and you will hear this term frequently when you do your house job and clinical rotation. Mannitol is an osmotic diuretic agent, and the clinical use is in the raised intracranial pressure or the raised intraocular pressure. So whenever there is increase in the intracranial pressure, mannitol is the drug of choice. Then we have carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Here in this figure, you can see the role of carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So carbonic anhydrase enzyme, if you remember, this causes the reversible reaction where H2CO3 carbonic acid is formed by the combination of water and carbon dioxide in the cell. And mind you, this is a reversible reaction. And the opposite events that take place outside the cell. Here, this carbonic acid is dissociated into water and carbon dioxide again. So this is the site of action for acetazolamide here. So carbonic anhydrase enzyme is blocked. So whenever there is block of this enzyme, this will affect the reabsorption of bicarbonate ions. So inhibition of bicarbonate reabsorption will cause acidosis. That is the reason excessive use of acetazolamide may lead to acidosis. And this is the site of action for carbonic anhydrase inhibitor at the proximal tubule. Just like the osmotic diuretic, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they act in the proximal tubule. Loop diuretics, furosemide, bumetanide, ethacrynic acid on the other hand, they act on the thick ascending limb. Here you can see the site of action. And we have discussed sodium, potassium, 2-chloride second reactive co-transporter is inhibited. So it increases the excretion of sodium ions, it increases the excretion of potassium ions, it increases the excretion of chloride ions as well. Another thing to remember is the effect on calcium reabsorption. So loop diuretics, they tend to inhibit reabsorption of calcium ions. So reabsorption of calcium is inhibited, and most of these calcium ions are excreted through the renal tract. And this is the distinguishing feature between loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics. Thiazide diuretics, they act on the distal tubule here. The type of transporter inhibited is sodium chloride second reactive co-transporter. And this is located in the distal tubule. Unlike loop diuretics, the effect on calcium reabsorption for thiazide diuretics is the opposite. So these agents, they tend to increase the reabsorption of calcium, or you can say decrease the excretion of calcium. Then there are multiple side effects of excessive use of thiazide diuretics, like hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia, hypercalcemia, and hyperuricemia. So not only the site of action for thiazide and loop diuretic is different, the type of transporter is different, the type of transporter which is inhibited is different. Moreover, the effect on calcium reabsorption is different as well. Then we have potassium sparing diuretics, aldosterone antagonist, that is spironolactone, and sodium channel blockers like amiloride and triamterene. So collective terminology for these aldosterone blockers and sodium channel blockers is the potassium retaining diuretics, and all these diuretics, they act on the late distal tubule and the collecting duct. Whether they block the actions of aldosterone or they block the sodium channels. Remember, triamterene and amiloride, these are sodium channel potassium sparing diuretics. They block the sodium channels. If you remember the ENaC channels, epithelial sodium channels, which are located in the distal, late distal tubule and the collecting duct. So these ENaC channels are inhibited or blocked by these diuretics, triamterene and amiloride. Now these are the effects on the electrolytes, the effect of diuretic agents on the electrolytes, especially the effect on sodium, the effect on chloride and potassium ions. So if you look at the urinary sodium and chloride, all the diuretics, they increase the urinary excretion of sodium and chloride ions. So excretion of sodium and chloride will be promoted. However, the content of these ions in the serum will be compromised. Similarly, loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, they are important in promoting excretion of potassium through the urine. Moreover, the levels of potassium in the blood will drop from normal level. And if you look at the blood pH, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors will reduce the pH, whereas loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, they will increase the pH of the blood. Or we can say carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they cause acidemia, and loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, they cause alkalemia. Whenever the pH is greater than 7.4 blood pH, this is labeled as alkalemia. When it is less than 7.35 or 7.4, this is acidemia. So why carbonic anhydrase inhibitors cause acidemia? Because they inhibit the reabsorption of bicarbonate. This is important. They inhibit the reabsorption of bicarbonate ions. Hence the pH will drop. And we have discussed the role of loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics on the calcium ions. So urinary calcium excretion is promoted by loop diuretics, and this will cause hypocalcemia. Thiazide diuretics, on the other hand, will decrease the levels of calcium through the urine. So opposite effects of loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics on calcium excretion. Now if we compare the relative changes in different ionic composition, we will start with the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, that is the acetazolamide. So you can see acetazolamide, it increases the urinary excretion of sodium, then it increases the excretion of potassium ions, it increases the excretion of bicarbonate ions and it promotes urinary volume output as well. Loop diuretics, they cause increased volume of urine, they cause increased excretion of sodium ions and increased excretion of potassium ions. The effect on sodium ion is greater than that produced by the CA inhibitor. Similarly, the effect on potassium excretion is relatively less than that produced by the acetazolamide. Moreover, there is contribution to the calcium excretion as well. So loop diuretics, as we have discussed, they also promote excretion of calcium ions as well. Thiazide diuretics and thiazide-like diuretics, on the other hand, will cause excretion of sodium and potassium and increase urinary output just like other types of diuretics. But the thing to remember is its effect on calcium excretion. So thiazide diuretics, they decrease the excretion of calcium ions. This means the reabsorption of calcium ions is promoted by thiazide diuretics. So opposite effect on calcium diuretics promote urinary excretion of calcium. Thiazide diuretics, they inhibit excretion of calcium. And then we have potassium sparing diuretics. So जी हुसैन सुन रहे हैं आप मुझे? उसमें देख रहे हैं आवाज आ रही? ओके, क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन प्लीज स्टार्ट कर दें. क्वेश्चन आंसर,
और ये अब्दुल रहमान को, इसको नहीं, अब्दुल रहमान
ऑल राइट स्टूडेंट्स, इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन वी स्टिल हैव टाइम. If you have any question, please let me know. Yes, your textbook is Guyton Physiology. You are supposed to go through Guyton. I have taken a few pictures from other textbooks as well, but these are just for your help. So you can consult this table 32.1. This is from your textbook. Moreover, you have to refer to this table as well. This is from Ganong Physiology. So these two tables are important for you people. The one from Guyton and the one from Ganong. If you have any query, please let me know. All the figures and diagrams and flowcharts that I have taken from other sources are just for the sake of description. You're not supposed to go through these textbooks that I have mentioned. These are just for the sake of description, for your better understanding. So no question. Okay, I will quickly review all the different types of diuretics. We will start with the osmotic diuretic. Osmotic diuretic will act on the proximal tubule. Similarly, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, these diuretics will also act on the proximal tubules. So, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, the classical example is acetazolamide. As the name indicates, this will inhibit the CA enzyme, carbonic anhydrase enzyme, and this will inhibit the reabsorption of bicarbonate through the proximal tubule. Loop diuretics will inhibit the sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter at the thick ascending limb. Right? So excretion of sodium will take place, excretion of potassium will take place, excretion of chloride will take place. If we compare loop with thiazide diuretics, the site of action is different. Thiazide diuretics act on the distal tubule and the type of transporter is different as well. Sodium chloride co-transporter. So again, excretion of sodium, excretion of chloride will be promoted. Then we have potassium sparing diuretics. So remember, aldosterone antagonists and sodium channel blockers, they are collectively known as potassium sparing diuretics. They affect the potassium excretion. So aldosterone antagonist is the spironolactone, and triamterene and amiloride, these will block the ENaC channels, epithelial sodium channels. And all these potassium sparing diuretics, they act on the distal tubule and the collecting ducts. So for you people, the minimum is to remember the site of action of each type of diuretic. At least 2 to 3 examples of each type of diuretic and the mechanism by which the diuretic agent is acting, whether it is inhibiting an enzyme or it is inhibiting a transporter in the specific segment of a renal tubule. Yes, any other question? These tables are taken from your textbook. This one and this is from Ganong's Physiology. You can see the complete list from Ganong's Physiology. So here you can see the role of water, ethanol, and vasopressin antagonists. So remember, these diuretics are not given in Guyton, but you have to remember these agents: water, ethanol, and aquaretics. So some of the agents, they act as diuretic agents like xanthine and calcium chloride, ammonium chloride, caffeine, theophylline. These agents can act as diuretics as well. So excessive use of caffeine may give you a diuretic effect as well. And we can classify these agents under the heading of diuretics as well. Yeah, we still have a minute or two. You can ask any question, any query. Yes, students, you can text any question if you want. Last minute going on. We still have a few seconds. All right, no questions. So the take-home message for today's session is: diuretic agents are the agents that promote excretion of water, that is diuresis, number one. Number two, this diuresis is secondary to natriuresis, that is is excretion of water molecules is in response to inhibition of sodium reabsorption. So inhibition of sodium reabsorption will cause natriuresis, and then the water molecules will tend to follow the sodium ions. Then there are different types of diuretics. The important types include osmotic diuretics, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, loop diuretics, thiazide diuretics, and potassium sparing diuretics. All these different types of diuretics, they act on different segments of the nephron. They act on different types of enzymes or transporters. Hence, they cause increased excretion of sodium, water, and other ions as well. And we clinically use these diuretic agents whenever we want to reduce the ECF volume, especially in hypertension, especially in edema and other cardiovascular related abnormalities. Thank you so much. Allah Hafiz.